Welcome back. This is part two of building my robot butler, Io. Last time we finished building Io's arms, along with the teleop setup to drive them, and then tested it with the same rigor and transparency found across the industry. Today, we'll be continuing development with this, Io's head, which you may have noticed looks a bit different from other humanoid robots out there. And that was sort of the point. All these, you know, real robotics companies treat the head of their robots like some kind of afterthought, sticking to the same old bland design that everybody else is using. But if you're going to go through the hassle to include a head anyways, why not have some fun with it? This is probably why. What was supposed to be a short little side project because I didn't want to make Io some hands, turned into several weeks of pain, multiple failed prototypes, and worst of all, it made me have to do math again. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's go over how Io ended up looking like this in the first place. Now, admittedly, I'm not the most creative person out there, if my naming sense didn't already make that obvious enough. But luckily for me, I don't have to be when there's already so much out there to steal from. I mean, be inspired by. So after conducting a couple extended sessions of market research, I decided to take a page out of one of my favorite games, Nier Automata. No, not her. That's for a different type of robot. I'm talking about these, the machine life forms. Sure, they're not quite humanoid, but I really like the way they look and how their head moves around. So let's make Io look like that.
Oh dear.
Easier said than done, though. You see, the problem with taking inspiration from games is that game designers don't need to worry about how their stuff would actually work in real life.
All of my bones are broken.
For the machine head, we have two problems to tackle. One, how does the head stay attached to its body? And two, even more of a mystery, how's the head able to seemingly move in any direction it wants? And after combing through concept art, wikis, and random Reddit threads to gather even the tiniest crumb of an explanation, the best I got is magic. So now it's my job to figure out how to make this design actually possible. My first idea kind of looked like this. The head is a hollow shell with a cutout at the bottom where a central column sticks through, kind of like a spine. This is what keeps the head attached to the body, and would also have motors at the end to make it turn. Now, to give the illusion that the head is still a complete sphere, like with the machine lifeform, we could use some of these decorative pieces to cover it up. There's just one problem. While this design lets the head turn in any direction, it can't turn all that far since the cutout limits the range of motion you can get. And if we just make it bigger, the illusion falls apart since it'll be too big to hide. So to work around this relatively minor limitation in the grand scheme of things, I decided to scrap this idea entirely and ended up with a design 10 times more complicated. Because that's what engineering's all about, masochism. Now, in order to get rid of the cutout and spine, I need a new way to keep the head in place. And I think I've got just the thing. Now, I know magnets seem like the obvious choice, but keep in mind, this head is entirely 3D printed. And I plan on keeping it that way for the finalized design too, since I don't own a CNC mill, and I certainly don't have the budget to get it machined for me. Which brings up a good question. How am I supposed to use magnets for a head that's not magnetic? Well, if we put a couple of them in the base that the head will sit on, and then put some corresponding ones on the inside of the head with this coupler piece, then the head gets magnetically sandwiched in between them. Throw in some ball bearings to reduce friction, and now the head stays attached to the base while still being able to freely rotate. That was easy enough, but now comes the hard part. How do we make the head actually move? First, I designed these drive units, which is just a motor spinning an omni wheel with a belt. Omni wheels are kind of like regular wheels, with the added benefit of being able to roll side to side. Like if you think about parallel parking a normal car, compared to that, if you had a car with omni wheels, then you could just line up with the spot and drive sideways directly into it. Anyways, by attaching three of these drive units to the base, so that the head rides on top of the wheels, we can now turn the head in any direction we want. To move the head left and right, we just need the wheels to be going in the same direction and at the same speed. If you think about it in 2D, it should be pretty clear why. To move the head up and down, all we need to do is run the front two wheels at the same speed, but in opposite directions. The quote-unquote horizontal movement from the wheels cancels out with each other, leaving just a resulting vertical movement. Meanwhile, the back wheel just stays in place, and because it's an omni wheel, it just serves as an idler to let the head roll freely. Now, moving the head side to side is a bit harder to reason through, because all three wheels need to be going at different velocities. It's the same idea as the previous example, though, but now you want to cancel out the vertical movement. But to go beyond these simple examples and have precise control over the movement, I need to solve for the kinematics of the head, which basically boils down to just a bunch of physics and linear algebra.
No.
Shouldn't be too bad, right?
Wait.
Now, to actually do something with the kinematic model, there's just one last thing we need. How do we keep track of where the head's at? After all, if we want to turn Io's head to a specific orientation, knowing where the head's currently at is pretty important. Originally, I was wondering if we already had everything we needed to keep track of this. After all, the drive units already keep their own position, thanks to the built-in encoder on the motor. And, well, we kinda can, through a technique called dead reckoning. Here's how that works. If you have the head's starting position, which you can do by making sure the head starts in the same spot every time Io boots up, then, whenever it moves, we can use the head's last position and the amount the wheels move by to estimate where the head should be at now. This then gets reused to help make the estimate for the next move. Now, this sounds all well and good on paper, but in reality, there's a bunch of stuff to consider that could introduce errors like backlash in the drive units or the unavoidable wheel slip. Without a way to correct for them, you're basically going at it blind, so these errors are going to accumulate and make our orientation estimates worse over time. And for Io, having the wrong orientation even for just a second or two, assuming it's off by enough, could cause it to tear its own head off, trying to get somewhere it thinks it can reach. Sure, I'm probably not going to run the real head this fast, but that's the kind of power these motors could kick out when things go wrong. So, dead reckoning's not going to work. We definitely need some sort of additional hardware to help us actively track the orientation. I thought maybe I could chuck one of these IMUs into the head, which combines readings from a bunch of different sensors, like accelerometers and gyros, to spit out an estimate of an object's orientation. So I was thinking, if these sensors are good enough to be used in your phone, surely it'll be good enough for Io, right? If only it was that easy. I'm not sure if it was just me being stubborn, or the brain damage finally caught up to me, but I spent way too much time trying to make this approach work. And work, it technically does, just not for long. You see, all IMUs, or at least all in my price range, suffer from something called drift, where the measured orientation becomes more and more off over time.
I am massively simplifying here.
First, there's the sensor readings the IMU relies on that always have a bit of noise in their measurements. This is unavoidable for just about any sensor, really, and by itself, this wouldn't be that big of a deal. But it becomes one because of the specific way these IMUs use these readings to calculate the orientation, resulting in all these errors accumulating over time. So even after just a few minutes of manhandling this prototype around, the IMU has drifted by over 45 degrees from where it should actually be. Now, this is fine for a phone, since on top of using other sensors like GPS to help correct for the error, it's not really a big deal when the direction of your blue dot in Google Maps is slightly off. For Io, though, could cause it to tear its own head off, trying to get somewhere it thinks it can reach. After I stopped being a dumbass and realized that this IMU approach just wasn't gonna work, I was this close to giving up on the head. Like, sure, the design is cool and all, but there's gotta be a point where it's just not worth the effort anymore. But quitting? When I was already this far? No, I couldn't. I was in too deep. For the sake of this video storyline, I had to keep going. So I doubled down. And then I doubled down again. And again. Until I finally came up with a solution. Which all came down to these magnets. Right now, when the head moves around, the magnetic coupler inside, keeping the head attached to the base, stays in the same spot. But with multiple pairs of magnets between them, this also locks the coupler into the same orientation as the base. Now, the light bulb went off when I realized that because of this, if we wanted the orientation of the head relative to the base, then all we needed was the orientation relative to the magnetic coupler, because they end up being the same. And thankfully, that was much easier to do. I printed out this simple contraption that pivots around with these three rotary encoders. This goes inside of the head, where one side mounts to the magnetic coupler, while the other connects to the back panel of the shell. So now, whenever we move the head, we can keep track of how much it moves by about each of these encoders' axis of rotation. All of these encoder values we get will be relative to the magnetic coupler, so that means they'll also be relative to the base. And with a bit of math, we can convert these encoder values into Io's exact head orientation. This approach doesn't suffer from drift like with the IMU, because even though we have sources of error, like the play in the magnetic coupler, or the encoder resolution, the errors we do get don't accumulate. So at any point in time, we could be off by a few degrees, and by could be, I mean probably, But the orientation reading, in theory, shouldn't ever become completely off. With orientation solved, all that's really left are some finishing touches. Since the head's going to be fully enclosed, we don't have the luxury of powering the electronics with a cable anymore. So instead, I'm throwing in this power bank and hoping it'll be beefy enough to last a full day. No cables also means we now need to send these encoder values to IO's computer wirelessly. Though, this wasn't a big deal to do since the code is basically copy and paste from the teleop setup in the last video. To make the head shell easier to print and assemble, I split it into multiple sections that are connected with these tiny 2mm dowel pins. I came up with a few different ways to connect them, but this was by far the best in making sure that the wheels and bearings glide smoothly on both sides of the shell. These pins also let me design this nice locking mechanism for the front and back panels, which twist to lock in place, and use just a single screw to make sure it stays that way. This makes the head super easy to open up, and despite the thin walls on these locking tabs, it's been holding up well, which is important because I need to open it up pretty often to recharge the power bank. Finally, I added some LEDs for the eyes, and a power switch to the front panel, which are connected via a slip ring to the main assembly. That should hopefully keep the wires from tangling up when it's rotating around. And that's how you build an over-engineered robot head. But now, let's take a look at what all this extra engineering was for. Because IO's head is now entirely self-contained, we can just remove the head off the base like this. Sure, there may not be a practical reason for it, but you gotta admit, it does look pretty cool with the head still on and eyes blinking. If I put it back on the base, we can demo the next party trick. That's right, the head can now spin indefinitely. Right now it's rotating around the yaw axis and can go for as long as the head has battery. This is possible because all the electronics inside are spinning along with the head. But it's not just yaw though. Because we have the slip ring in place for the front panel, we can have it rotate continuously around the roll axis too. The sounds coming out of it are a bit concerning, but it's better not to worry, so I'm not gonna. And while it's a shame the head can't rotate forever about the pitch axis too, it can still move a pretty good amount. If we really wanted to make it spin forever, one, we would need a ditched encoder solution, and two, we would have to somehow fit all the electronics and a spare battery for the eyes inside the 4mm thick head shell. So yeah, that's not going to be happening anytime soon. Also, continuing with making IO fully teleoperable, I did a bit more coding to hook up IO's head for some face tracking. So what you're seeing right now is IO following my head position and eye blinks in real time, which are just being captured from a phone I have off to the side. Despite all the spaghetti code and relying on spotty Wi-Fi, the tracking actually seems to be working pretty well, and it's not having any trouble keeping up speed-wise. So I think with that, I can call IO's head complete. I'm one step closer to having IO terrorizing a home near you. Next up will be building IO a proper torso, so it can finally combine the head and arms together. So be sure to stay tuned for that. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.